Well, we left off talking about our challenge to be different. We were in verse 17 of chapter 1. Verse 17 of chapter 1. And if you call on him as Father, who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. Thank you, Bob. Yeah, just kind of, that's right. There you go. This whole idea of fear or reverence is probably a better word. We are to live in holiness, first of all, and we are to walk in fear or reverence. Conduct yourselves in fear, in reverence. With reverential fear. Why? Why should we conduct ourselves with fear? Well, if we're going to address him as Father, and if we're going to have that one-on-one kind of a relationship with him in fellowship and in prayer, then we need to conduct ourselves as those who one day are going to stand before him and give an account. That's what the Bible tells us, in case that's a surprise to anyone. Romans chapter 14 and verse 12. Each one of us will give an account of himself, herself, to the Lord. So yes, when we die, we're going to be brought before the judgment seat of Christ, and that's not the bad judgment, it's the good judgment, but yet it's a judgment nonetheless. And we're going to independently give an account for our lives before God, and we're going to see life pass in review, and he's going to reward accordingly. It's not a judgment to see whether or not we get into heaven, because we know that that's already a done deal. The Bible says that God will test the quality of each person's work. 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 13. You ever had somebody check your work? Cliff, we can set up some counseling afterwards if it would help. Too late, huh? Mary, doesn't he just sound like a poor put-upon fella? I'll tell you. You know, if I didn't know better, I'd say, just go fishing. Yeah. Oh, my. So, yes, we're going to give an account. God's going to test the quality of your work. You ever had somebody check your work at work? Quality control, right? That's what they call it anyway. Micromanaging. Yeah, sure. Oh, that's ridiculous. You know, I mean, Susan loves those days when the principal comes in and observes her classroom, right? It's like, at this point, I'm not going to do anything different than I've ever done before. So if you want to come, that's fine. Check it off your list. But yeah, this whole idea of testing your work, testing what we have done in our lives for the cause of Christ. Think of the things that you've done in your life as a believer as being all loaded up into the back of a great big old dump truck. And that dump truck, beep, 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 it backs up, dumps that stuff all out. And then the Lord comes along, and he looks over the pile of your life, and then he sets it afire. And only the good stuff survives. Gold, silver, precious stones, as opposed to the wood, hay, and stubble of our lives that is consumed. Oh, here's a little bit of silver. Oh, there's a piece of gold over there. Oh, look, here's an emerald. That's really great. But whoosh. 1988 Olympics in Korea, Ben Johnson of Canada. You remember Ben Johnson? He was the one who won the 100-meter dash. He set a new world and Olympic records. And our guy was a fellow named Carl Lewis. Remember Carl Lewis? And he came in second. And it was a shock that he had not won. And then it was after the fact that the judges learned that Johnson had used steroids. And so they disqualified him and gave the medal to Carl Lewis. The world may be impressed by our outward deeds from what they see, but remember, it's God who does the judging. God looks at the inside. God sees what's really there. That's one of the reasons why we should conduct ourselves in fear. The Christian life is a tough fight. Really, truly. Pride and pleasure, all the things of this world, they are so alluring. How can we run this race without being disqualified, without forfeiting our reward? Well, he picks it up in verse 18, where he tells us that we need to focus our minds. Look at verse 18. Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The battle with the world is a battle of the mind. And that is where the enemy wants to focus his efforts. Our minds. Our minds need to be focused on Christ. How does that happen? We need to understand a few things. We need to understand who Jesus is in order for us to focus our minds on him. We need to understand that this is the one who delivered us from slavery. He's the one who provided the out for us. Whether we know it or not, we were trapped in a lifestyle that had nothing to offer. Really and truly, only emptiness, empty pleasures, dead-end promises. Didn't measure up to anything. And then secondly, Jesus was the one who came near and made himself known. And that's why he tells us in verses 20 and 21, that he appeared so that your faith and hope are in God. So in order for us to be able to do that, to have this different lifestyle, living in holiness, walking in here, keeping our mind focused, there are a number of techniques that we need to pay close attention to. And the first one is pay close attention to what you look at. Takes us back to verse 13, doesn't it? Again, look at verse 13 and see for yourself. Gird our minds, keep sober, fix our hope. Those are all action words. You know, our eyes tend to be the closest connection to our minds, don't they? Have you noticed that? We bring information to our minds through the eyes. We read it. We see visual images. We feed our imaginations through our eyes. We focus on things that are alluring, things that are attractive. And don't kid yourself. Sin is extremely attractive. It can be tempting. It's attractive for a while. But remember, the Bible tells us that Moses gave up the passing pleasures of sin when he was in Egypt so that he could walk with the people of God. Yeah, the world, the cosmos, offers pleasures, no doubt about it. But those pleasures are passing. They're not going to last. And that is why when Paul wrote to the Colossians in chapter 3, he said, listen, if you've been raised up with Christ, keep seeking things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. Set your minds, focus your minds on things above, not on the things of the earth. Because you have died, he says, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. So first, we need to pay close attention to what we're looking at. Secondly, we need to give more thought to the consequences of sin rather than to the pleasures of sin. This, I think, is where we lose so badly, is that we don't take the time to think beyond. We don't stop and think about where sin will take us. We only see all the glamour and the allure and the temptation, but we don't stop and think about what's it going to be like the day after. What's it going to be like after the thrill is finished? Randy Alcorn is an author, written a number of books, and in an article that he put in Leadership Magazine, he wrote this article, Consequences of a Moral Tumble. And he said that whenever he's feeling particularly vulnerable to sexual temptation, he finds it very helpful to think about what the long-term effects could be. And this is a list of some of the things that he mentions. Grieving the Lord who redeemed me. One day having to look Jesus in the face and give an account for my actions. Inflicting untold hurt on your best friend and loyal spouse and losing his or her respect and trust. Hurting my beloved children. Destroying my example and credibility with my children and nullifying both present and future efforts to teach them to obey God. Causing shame to my family. Creating a form of guilt awfully hard to shake. Even though God would forgive me, would I forgive myself? Forming memories and flashbacks that could plague future intimacy with my spouse. Wasting years of training and experience in ministry for a long time, maybe permanently. Undermining the faithful example and hard work of other Christians in our community. Bringing great pleasure to Satan, the enemy of God. Possibly bearing the physical consequences of such diseases as gonorrhea, syphilis, chlamydia, herpes, and AIDS, maybe even causing the death of my spouse. Possibly causing pregnancy with the personal and financial implications, including a lifelong reminder of my sin, and causing shame and hurt to my friends, especially those I've led to Christ and discipled. My, oh my, oh my, what a list. What a list. And that's just a partial list. So we have to take a realistic side of the other side of sin. What's it going to look like after the fact? How is my engaging in this sinful attitude, action, activity, what's this going to look like afterwards? How's this going to possibly change things? I think if we would take the time and do that, boy, I think it would solve a lot of questions in our minds, wouldn't it? All the time. Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yep. Yeah. Okay. All right. In that order, too, Mary. I'd watch out if I were you. Yes. Yep. It is. It is. It is. Oh, yes. And here's Ken Kamrowski with the day's weather forecast. Thirdly, we need to begin each day by renewing our sense of reverence for God. When you wake up in the morning, what do? Grab your phone and check the scores? See what's going on in Fox News? Check your emails? See who Instagrammed you overnight? What do you do? What do you do? You open your eyes and say, Lord, thank you for another day. Help it to be a good day. Help me to focus upon you. Talk to the Lord, even if it's a brief talk. I'm here, Lord. I'm yours. I want to affirm that I reverence you and I give you today. And because I am frail and because I am fragile, Lord, I need your help through it all. And then lastly, periodically during each day, focus fully on Christ. Focus fully on Christ. What's that look like? I think it looks like two people who are in love in a long-distance relationship where you find someone who maybe through the day is just kind of not there because they're somewhere else. And they're thinking about that person that they love. They got that faraway, starry-eyed gaze. You know, thinking maybe of the other person just sitting by the phone waiting for the call later on. And there's that thought. You know, and you can say like, hey, you're listening to me? No, because they're somewhere else. Maybe it's a little bit like that with respect to the Lord, keeping in mind that there is coming a day. There is coming a day far down the line when things are going to be different. And all this stuff is going to be over and done with. Mm-hmm. Mm. Any other thoughts? It's all easy to do, right? Jim, isn't it easy for you to do this? All of this, isn't all this easy? This Christian stuff? It's easy, right? Sure. So why we need the Lord's help. We need his intervention throughout it all. And so, Father, as we conclude this portion of your word, we thank you for it and ask that you will remind us of keeping our hearts and our minds focused upon you and not all of the things that are going on around us. As the songwriter has written, turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. For we ask it in Jesus' name.